In the beginning, God said, let there be, and there was light. God separated, and he made day and night. When God spoke, the whole earth began to reap. His voice alone created mountains high and valleys oh so deep. And then God revealed his plan and said, let us make man. And when God breathed in him, man began to live. So let him breathe on me. Let him breathe on me. For when he breathes on me, I live abundantly. Let him breathe on you. Let him breathe on you. For when he breathes on you, he'll make your life brand new. In conclusion, we are taught. A sentence ends with a period, and that's a complete thought. But you better watch out when God drops in a comma, because there's about to be some wonderful, amazing drama.
The blackness, keep the game on.
Black History Month is a great time to celebrate the excellence and achievements of so many men, women, and children of the past and present. But it's important to understand that Black history goes beyond the names we normally hear about. Today, IBOC would like to begin a new series to recognize Black excellence in our own church family. Throughout the rest of this year, we will highlight our brothers and sisters who are making a difference in our community and making a difference for Christ. One of our very own members is making history every day, and this is her story. This is Sister Margaret Sherrills, affectionately known around IBOC as the Fish Lady. She's a proud member of IBOC, a praise dancer, and a full-time caretaker of all the animals and marine life at the Inspiring Body of Christ Church. Her daily responsibilities range from taking care of small tasks to big tasks, really big tasks. The largest privately owned aquarium in the world, and an 80,000 gallon tank with creatures from all over the globe. And Margaret is on the aquatics team that maintains all of it.
Okay, so I'm originally from Gary, Indiana, and I've been in Texas since 98. When I graduated from high school, I went to the University of North Texas, mm-hmm. and I've just been in Texas ever since then. I've been at IBOC for 21 years, I think. I grew up, it was five of us, I'm the youngest of five. I pretty much grew up with my two brothers and my dad and my mom, and so my dad kind of set that foundation for me loving animals. We would go fishing, and that was basically the highlight, you know, of my childhood years, just going fishing with my dad. That was my fondest memory of my dad. He passed in 2017, mm-hmm. so I always think about, you know, man, thank you, Dad, for just teaching me how to fish and just taking me along. I grew up with a fear of swimming. Now, I love the water, I love to fish, I love to just see water, but actually being in water and swimming in water, I was terribly afraid of it. When our pastor told us, he announced that we're building a church, and we are gonna need people to swim and swim with fish and swim with stingrays, and that's how he put it. Yeah. And I remember sitting in the congregation, and I immediately said, I'm going to do that. At the time, I don't even know how to swim, because at the time I didn't even know how to swim.
Really?
I was still afraid of water, but I knew that I wanted to be swimming with sharks and stingrays. I knew that that's something that I wanted to do. Actually, the night before I went to get certified to dive, to be a certified diver, my best friend taught me how to swim in her apartment. She was living in an apartment at the time, and they had a pool, and she taught me how to swim that evening. It definitely is God. When we had to take our test, and I was the only African American there,
right.
And when we had to stay afloat for maybe 12 minutes or so, and I prayed the entire 12 minutes. Initially, you know, you think about being a diver, oh yeah, it's so much fun, you know, you just get in and get in and swim with the fish and sharks and stingrays. But like you said, there is a process.
Mm-hmm.
They do have to be quarantined. Once they come in from the ocean, they have to be set aside for a while in order for us to ensure that they're healthy enough to join the rest of the community. Behind the scenes, we have to prepare them to be on display. And so we have to do water quality. We have to make sure that they're fed. We have to make sure that they get acclimated to people.
Mm-hmm.
And so there is a process. It's not just get in and swim and wave at people. And you do have to do some behind the scenes work. This is not just a job for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is something that I'm passionate about. It's an absolute blessing. One of the things that I do before I dive is I actually pray, and I thank God for the opportunity. Once I get in the water, it's just me and just silence, you know, and it's just so peaceful. And so I just often reflect on just the blessings, and I reflect on the encouragement from our congregation, because a lot of people, they rely on us, they rely on the aquatics team to give them the information that they don't know about the fish. You know, everybody doesn't want to dive.
Right.
Everybody does not desire to get in that water and swim. And so we have the responsibility as the aquatics team to pass on the information that we know and to educate our congregation on what it is that we know. Like I said, when I first heard that we were gonna actually have an aquarium, an 80,000 gallon aquarium in our church, you know, I couldn't believe it. You know, I was wondering, like, wow, what an awesome vision. And so I just thank Pastor Rush for allowing God to give him that vision. And it's just amazing.
You know, we think of Shirley Chisholm, Kamala Harris, you know, Maxine Waters, the list goes on and on. So many African-American women who have performed great feats here in the country. And now the name Margaret Shirls is added to that mix of someone who's doing something extraordinary to break barriers and to break stereotypes, to now be considered an African-American history figure. And this is going to go on for decades now, that you're one of the very few, if not the first. Talk about that close affinity with other historical African-American female figures, and now to have your name kind of mentioned and synonymous with that. How does that make you feel?
I don't know. You know, I hadn't even thought about it that way.
Yeah.
I'm just doing what I like to do. You know, I don't think about it as something being, oh, you know, it's history. But
what about those other little black girls coming up 3 and 4 years old who don't have their dad in their life, and you're showing something different, obviously.
Yeah.
Talk to that little black girl about what they can be.
I think it's all about exposure. It starts with exposure. You know, as a little girl, my dad exposed me to fish and to water and to animals. And so that's where that passion came. And so for the little girls out there that are looking and listening, you know, you can do it. You can do whatever it is. I know it may seem out of the box, but whatever it is that's in your heart, whatever that passion is, you can do it. You can do it. For me, I see African-American females every single day that I look up to. The just regular people. Oh, here I go.
It's okay. So where does that come from? That tears of joy, tears of sadness. Let's talk about that. Where is that coming from?
It's tears of joy, you know, it's tears of just gratitude. Mm-hmm. The women who I see every day, my mom, Sister Orr, I know you don't know that, but
she's running around here somewhere.
Yes, just the women that I see every single day, I'm just honored and blessed to be around.
Wow. And now some little black girl around here is going to look at Sister Cheryl's and said, wow, I'm just honored to just be around.
Sister Margaret's dream is to teach more kids about the beauty of animals and aquatics, which is why she wrote the book, My Friends and Me at IBOC. All of the proceeds benefit the University of Dreams, and one day she wants to take her message to Sesame Street.
If you're going to have a dream, first of all, do something that God has laid on your heart that seems natural. Your dreams are going to be natural. And find someone like Margaret's dad. You know, find someone who can inspire that, who can invest in that, and who can help you capture that, and who can encourage that. And then you'll get the competence for it. And I believe the consistency goes along with that. So if there's someone listening here now who says, I have a fear of this and I have a fear of that. Sometimes those fears are very natural. I never get in this water. See, I respect the bottom. But Sister Margaret and her team, a lot of them probably had the same fears. Mm-hmm. And what they did was had to have the confidence in those of us who said, we'll make sure that everything is right. Mm-hmm. It's a call to trust. So when you develop a dream, God will put you around people that you can trust. Now that doesn't mean that things won't go wrong. It just means that you have to make the next step. I think she's an excellent model for anyone who says, I want to go for something and I want to keep going for other things, because her because is because of what she can do in the body of Christ. I've never known her to do anything because of Margaret. If you do something for something greater than yourself, God will support it. God will finance it. God will back it, and you'll achieve it.
Sister Margaret, thank you for being an inspiring symbol of Black excellence, and thank you for representing Christ. The best is yet to come in your life.